I'm quite excited about the message today, where we ended up in the whole genealogy that leads towards Jesus. Because we will learn some very special things that we know, but we don't know why. And most Christians don't. That is why Maria had to be Jesus' biological mother, and it could not have been just any other woman. Why, in spite of the fact that it was a virgin birth, actually we will also learn why it had to be a virgin birth, and it could not be otherwise, and we will also learn why, in spite of that, she had to marry to Joseph, and not just anybody. All of this is very specific. So we will learn today why this is and why God has arranged it like that. And why Jesus, only Jesus, could be the true Messiah and no one else. And as we go through all the names, as we did the past weeks, we've seen that God is writing history as it moves on. He's revealing his plans and showing he is in control and he's at work. It's a lesson also for us in our lives. That is how he also wants to lead us in our lives. He's always ahead and we ought to follow. And he's in control because he knows the end already. And the greatest gift, of course, that God has given is his son, Jesus. Through that, we are redeemed. We have life. So to see how God has revealed this through history is beautiful to follow this. And also as we see the messages that appear, we see the love and care that God has for his creation and for each and every one of us. So we will today look at some historical facts, some legal facts. We will actually be a little bit like legal, do some legal examination. We will also look at some biological matters. And all of this is important. The last week we ended with the 44th generation from Adam. And we have also seen that we started following the genealogy as it is recorded in the Gospel of Luke in chapter 3. But at some point we had to skip to Matthew. Today we will also learn what is the difference between these two. Because actually, up till King David, they are the same. And then they are completely different until we arrive at Joseph, Jesus' father, earthly father. So we will also find out why that is so. So we continue with name or generation 45, which is in this chart, this blue pie. So we go towards there. And what we speak about today will also be fitting in the season that we live in. Regardless of how important it is for us, but I will address that coming Sunday, Lord willing, but it's the season where we remember often Jesus' birth, and so it has everything, of course, to do with that as well. And if I would give this message today a title, it came to my mind, I would call it Mission Impossible. Why? Because God created conditions for Jesus to be born as the Messiah that were actually impossible to meet. if you see the restrictions and the conditions that God has created, humanly spoken, no one could ever fulfill this. And that is exactly how God works. He makes things impossible for man. That is how he can manifest himself. There's no one ever in history who could claim to be the Messiah except Jesus. So it's really mission impossible, but God, for God, nothing is impossible, of course. So let's go to Matthew chapter 1 to find the next name. And we have to go to verse 10. And Ezekiah begat Manasseh, and Manasseh begat Amon. Amon is the next one we have to go to. We ended last week with Manasseh. I will revisit Manasseh, by the way, in a few minutes. But so Amon is the next. I will not say too much about him, except that his name means master workman or master builder. So he is the 45th in line, 45th generation from Adam. Remember, Matthew starts with Abram, not with Adam, so that's why we began in Luke, because Luke starts all the way from Adam. Matthew, he starts with Abram. Anyway, then we right away we go to the next one, which is also there in verse 10. It says, and Amon begat Josias. Josiah. Josias, you see the names are rendered here a bit different than in the Old Testament, because this is the Greek rendering of the Hebrew name, but it's Josiah. And as we saw last week, the ending Yah is from Yahweh, it's God. So this means whom the Lord healed, whom God healed. Matthew divides the generations from Abram to Jesus in three parts. He goes from Abram to King David. King David obviously is very important because he is Jesus is called the son of David. He is from the lineage of David. David was the first real king. Technically Saul was, but David was the apple of God's eye. So he goes from Abram to David, and then from David to the Babylonian captivity, and then from the Babylonian captivity to Jesus. These are the three sections in which Matthew divides the generations, and each are 14 generations. He explains this here in verse 17. And now, with the next generation, we enter into this this time of the Babylonian captivity. And we see that it is a crucial time, and it's very, for an important reason, that Matthew makes a division there. Well, Matthew is, of course, inspired by the Holy Spirit when he writes this. So the next one would be, if we read it here in verse 11, and Josias begat Jechonias and his brethren about the time they were carried away to Babylon. So here we have the division. Now, Josias had another son, actually, an older son, who would follow him, but something happened to this son, and we can read about this in Jeremiah chapter 22. Jeremiah 22, verse 11 and 12. For thus said the Lord, touching Shallum, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, which reigned instead of Josiah his father, which went forth out of his of this place, he shall not return thither any more. But he shall die in the place whither they have led him captive, and shall see this land no more. So Shallum was actually the successor, but he would die, and therefore the next son, Jehoiakim, would follow. So Matthew doesn't mention even mention Shallum, he goes right away to Jehoiakim. Now Jehoiakim was not the original name. It's very interesting what happens to his name. We can read this in 2 Kings chapter 23. 2 Kings chapter 23, we see the old name of Jehoiakim. And this ties in very much with what I explained last week about these names. 2 Kings 23, verse 34. And even if you ever read this before, you might not have realized what happens there, but from now on you will understand this. It says there, verse 34, and Pharaoh Necho made Eliakim, the son of Josiah, king in the room of Josiah, his father, and turned his name to Jehoiakim. Until there. So his name was Eliakim, and it became Jehoiakim. Now, maybe you remember, El means God. But El is a general name, annotation for God. So it can also refer to any God, actually. Whereas Yahweh, or the extension Yah, points to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of the Bible. So his name was Eliakim and became Jehoiakim. So instead of God, it became now clear that he belonged to Jehovah, to Yahweh, I should say. That is what happens here. So it becomes more specific with God, because the full name means who the Lord raised up. And by changing his name, it becomes clear that it was Yahweh who raised him up, and not just any God. So it's an interesting change of names. And during his reign, the Israelites were carried into captivity, into Babylon, which was actually something God allowed to happen because of their disobedience. They had not obeyed God's law, and they would now, one of the main things was they had not kept the Sabbath, the seventh day, and so they would be led into captivity for 70 years. It's very similar to what happened when they were in the desert. They reached the promised land. The explorers were for 40 days in the promised land. They returned, and then they talked about these giants. They became scared, and God gave them 1 year for every day, so 40 years in the desert. Very same thing happens here. So that's why they were led in captivity. It's also here in 2 Kings, the next chapter, 24, in the first verse. And it says there, in his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his servant 3 years. Then he turned and rebelled against him. So it says here, Jehoiakim became his servant, which means instead of being a sovereign king over Judah, he now was more like a governor. He was now the servant of Nebuchadnezzar. He was still ruling, but under Nebuchadnezzar, so to speak, for 3 years, and then he rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar, and he died because of that. Now, in Matthew, he simply mentions Jehoiakim, and then in the next verse, he continues with the son of Jehoiakim, as if during the 70 years, there was only one king. This is not correct, as we will see. There was this Jehoiakim who was the king when the captivity started, and there was a Jehoiachim who was king when the captivity ended. They were not the same. This was father and son, actually. And we find it here in verse 6 of 2 Kings 24. It says, so Jehoiakim slept with his fathers. It means he was buried. And Jehoiachim, his son, reigned in his stead. So here you see these are two with almost the same name, but they are two different persons. In Matthew, you will only find one name. So Matthew really goes until the captivity and from the captivity. He doesn't distinguish what happens in between. So the next one, after Jehoiakim, is Jehoiachin. And Jehoiachin goes actually with three names. Jehoiachin is one of the three names, and we will also go to his other two names that he is listed with. One is to be found in Jeremiah 22. It will all become clear why this is so. Jeremiah 22, verse 24. And you might want to afterwards keep your finger here, because I come back to this chapter in a minute. But now only just this first verse, Jeremiah 22, verse 24. As I live, said the Lord, though Coniah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, were the singet upon my right hand, yet would I pluck thee thence. So here we see Coniah, the son of Jehoiakim. This is the same as Jehoiachin. Jehoiachin is also called Coniah. And the third name we can find in 1 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 16. Also here, it's a whole genealogy. And we see here, and the sons of Jehoiakim, Jeconiah, his son, Jeconiah. So we have Jehoiachin, Coniah, and Jeconiah. It's three names for the same person. And the meaning of the names is actually similar. Only the tense is different. What does it mean? Jehoiachin means Yahweh establishes or upholds. And Jeconiah is Yahweh will uphold. It's future tense. It's present future. And Coniah means Yahweh has upheld. It's past tense. So we combine the three and then we see it is whom the Lord upholds, will uphold, and did uphold. So we have three. And this reminds us right away of who God is. And that is the message here, of course. In Revelation 1, verse 8, Jesus says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, which is, which was, and which is to come. Revelation 1, verse 8. And that is what we see here in these three names. And this person, Jeconiah, in his life, something very crucial happens that will set the rest of history towards the Messiah. That is so important that it defines everything, actually. This Jeconiah was actually a wicked king. He was a very bad man. And he reigned only 3 months. And then he was carried into Babylon. And there he died after being in prison for 37 years. He was wicked, and he was so wicked that God put a curse on him. And this curse determined the fate of all of the descendants up to Jesus. And that's what I meant before. This is something where you would think now God makes it impossible for himself to fulfill his plan. But it's interesting. I want to read this curse. It's in Jeremiah 22, where we were before. Because we know that Jesus had to be a descendant of David, King David. And so, of course, as we are following the lines, Jeconiah was. But now something happens. In Jeremiah 22, verse 24 until verse 30. As I live, said the Lord, though Coniah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, were the singet upon my right hand, yet would I pluck thee thence. And I will give thee into the hand of them that seek thy life, and into the hand of them whose face thou fearest, even into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and into the hand of the Chaldeans. And I will cast thee out, and thy mother that bare thee, into another country where you were not born, and there you shall die. But to the land whereunto they desire to return, thither shall they not return. Is this man, Coniah, a despised broken idol? Is he a vessel wherein is no pleasure? Wherefore are they cast out? He and his seed are cast out into a land which they know not. O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord. Thus said the Lord, write you this man childless, a man that shall not prosper in his days, for no man of his seed shall prosper, sitting upon the throne of David and ruling any more in Judah. Here God puts a curse on Coniah and his seed, which means his generations, his offspring. None of them, he says, will sit on the throne of David and rule. Basically, disqualifying the descendants of Jeconiah for being king, for inheriting the kingship. So that would basically rule out Jesus as being the king because of this blood curse. It's a blood curse. It's on his seed, which means his physical descendants. So this is very interesting because now, yeah, you would say that here it ends. End of God's plan for the Messiah. It cannot be through this line anymore because of this curse. And it's strange because God had promised that the Messiah would be a descendant of King David. And how is this now going to work out? We have to go to 1 Chronicles to see what God had promised initially. And then we have to see how this is being solved. 1 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 11. It is where God promises David that from his offspring the Messiah will be born. This is often called the Davidic covenant. We have the Abrahamic covenant, we have the Davidic covenant. Verse 11, chapter 17. And it shall come to pass when thy days be expired, this is God speaking to David, that thou must go to be with thy fathers, that I will raise up thy seed after thee, which shall be of thy sons. And I will establish his kingdom. He shall build me a house, and I will establish his throne forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son, and I will not take my mercy away from him as I took it from him that was before thee. But I will settle him in mine house and in my kingdom forever, and his throne shall be established forevermore. God is promising David that from his seed, from his offspring, there will be the Messiah who will be king forever. Also interesting that God says he will be my son. He doesn't say he will be your son. He will be my son, God says. And I will be his father. So God promises to David, it's from your seed. But then, so many generations later, he tells Jeconiah that no one from your seed will sit on the throne. So this seems now a contradiction, and as if God has changed his mind. So no one of the descendants of Jeconiah could qualify for king of Israel. And we know that one of the attributes of the Messiah would be king of Israel. Now the genealogy that we are following goes to Joseph. And we have to remember that Joseph was not Jesus' biological father. He was only his legal father. So it's a blood curse. It's on the seed. Jesus did not have the seed, the genes of Joseph. So the blood curse is not transferred from Joseph to Jesus. The question, however, is how then did Jesus inherit the kingship if Joseph was actually not his biological father. And God has provided a solution. God made it actually so difficult that no one could step in there and claim this position of being the Messiah. Or if by error the Jews would think of a certain man that he would be the Messiah, Scripture would always contradict it, because no man could fill in this place. That is why God had made it so difficult. And also, we see that it is often through difficulties, or even through seemingly impossibilities, that God manifests, that God works. When we give up hope, when we think it can't be done, then God can reveal himself and can manifest his power. That's how he can work. And we are often the other way around. We give up. We even give up on God. There are many examples of people that when the misery in their life starts in whatever shape or form, they start to blame God. And they give up on God. But God works the other way around. That is when he can do his work. How is it going to work? There is here is also the reason why we have two different genealogies, one in Luke and one in Matthew. In Luke, he was a physician, and we also spoke about this when we talked about the tabernacle. The way Luke describes Jesus, he describes him as the Son of Man. He calls him the Son of Man, and looks at the human aspects of Jesus. And of course, that's the whole reason God used Luke to write this gospel, because that is the way Luke was thinking, apparently. And we see this also in the book of Acts, the way Luke writes. And so he presents him as the Son of Man, and he avoids this curse in the genealogy. And you see, as soon as we come to King David, that Luke goes to Nathan, David's son Nathan. He doesn't go to Solomon, he goes to Nathan. And from Bathsheba, David had two sons. One was Solomon, and the other was Nathan. These were the two that survived. So Luke goes to the line of Nathan. And then he continues all the way to Heli, and he says Heli was Joseph's father. Now that is technically not so, because Heli was Mary's father. So what is Luke doing? He is following the line from David to Nathan to Mary. But he doesn't mention Mary, because he only mentions the men and not the women. So instead of Mary, he mentions Joseph, the son of Jesus. Or the father of Jesus, sorry. So, actually, Luke is following the genealogy to Mary. Whereas Matthew, he goes through King Solomon. And then all the way down to Joseph. So, Matthew 1 records the genealogy from Abraham to Joseph. Luke 3 records the genealogy from Adam to Mary. And then we have the difference. And the reason is this curse. Luke avoids the curse by following another line. And that's why from David on, you see completely different names and a different number of generations. So Matthew focuses on the kingship, on the messiahship, actually, of Jesus. He calls him the Son of God, where Luke follows the human aspect, the Son of Man. There's a difference. And Matthew goes back to the inheritance of the tribe of Judah. Jesus is the king of Judah, the lion of Judah, Ariel Yehuda. So Mary was Jesus' only human parent. And it is through her ancestry that Jesus inherits the kingship, not through Joseph. Although this type of inheritance, as being a member of the tribe, only goes through the father in the Jewish tradition. So by having Joseph as his legal father, he was part of the tribe of Judah. And by having Mary as his biological mother, he received the kingship. But that does not just work like that. There is a whole legal procedure in the Judaic law, which is actually God's law, as you will see, in order to make this possible. And all these conditions are met, as we will see. That is why it's so specific, Joseph and Maria, that it's these two and not just two people. Yeah, we have to go back to the Old Testament because we have to find now how could Jesus inherit this this kingship through a woman. Because this in those days, all the inheritance went always through the men. Yeah, that is the whole reason why Luke only names the men in the genealogy. And even calls Heli Joseph's father, although it's Mary's father. So we go to Numbers, chapter 26. And that is talks about the moment that the Israelites have reached the promised land. And Moses is still alive, but it's the very end of Moses' life. And they know that when they enter the land will be divided so that each tribe and each family within the tribe gets a portion of the land. And that's their inheritance, so to speak. But now there is a man in the tribe of Manasseh who does not have sons, but he has a bunch of daughters. And now what are we going to read? What happens there? Numbers 26, verse 33. And Zelophehad, the son of Hepher, had no sons, but daughters. And the names of the daughters of Zelophehad were Mahla, Noah, Mokla, Milka and Tirza. Only daughters. And so they would, according to the law, inherit nothing. And this means that the end of this specific family line, would end there. And so the daughters, they see this coming and they bring this issue before Moses, so that Moses can tell them what to do. And that is in the next chapter, Numbers 27, in the first 11 verses. It's maybe a bit long, but this is all history. It's verifiable history. It's not made up. Many people think, oh, this is just in the Bible. No, this is history. There is a lot of other writings, not biblical, that record all these names and dates. So this is it's very accurate history, actually. Chapter 27, verse 1. Then came the daughters of Zelophehad, the son of Hepher, the son of Gilead, the son of Machir, the son of Manasseh, of the families of Manasseh, the son of Joseph. So it goes back here to Joseph, who had in these 12 tribes. And these are the names of his daughters: Mahla, Noah, Nokla, Milka, and Tirza. And they stood before Moses and before Eleazar. Eleazar was the successor of Aaron, the priest, and before the princes and all the congregation, by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, "Our father died in the wilderness, and he was not in the company of them that gathered themselves together against the Lord in the company of Korah, but died in his own sin and had no sons." What it means here that all these Israelites, the men that were 20 years and older when they first arrived the promised land, they would die in the desert. Their father, Zelophehad, was not of them, so he was actually eligible to reach the promised land. But they say he died in his own sin, so he died nevertheless. What the sin was, I don't know, but that is what it means anyway here. Then in verse 4 they continue, why should the name of our father be done away from among his family? Because he had no son. Give unto us therefore a possession among the brethren of our father. Now Moses was considered the leader. He was actually appointed by God to be the leader. And everybody knew this. That's why they went to him. And here it's towards the end of Moses' life. So he was maybe 118, 119 years old. And wise, we may assume. But he did not make a decision there. He did what all of us should do when an issue is presented before us. In verse 5, and Moses brought their cause before the Lord. He prayed to God, he asked God what to do with this matter. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, from this, by the way, we know that what follows now, it's from God. The daughters of Zelophehad speak right. Thou shalt surely give them a possession of an inheritance among their father's brethren, and thou shalt cause the inheritance of their father to pass unto them. And thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, saying, and now God has given a specific answer for this case, and now he comes with a general answer for similar cases. Verse 8, if a man die and have no son, then you shall cause his inheritance to pass unto his daughter. And if he have no daughter, then you shall give his inheritance unto his brethren. And if he has no brethren, then you shall give his inheritance unto his father's brethren. And if his father have no brethren, then you shall give his inheritance unto his kinsman that is next to him of his family, and he shall possess it. And it shall be unto the children of Israel a statute of judgment, as the Lord commanded Moses. This is a law, is a legal ordinance for inheritance, law of inheritance. And this law, almost in this form, is used today in most of the parts of the world like this. And we see this is from God. So in this case, it means that the inheritance was given to the daughters. But there is a catch, because there was also another law that if a woman would marry, the possessions would go to the family of the husband. So meaning that if these daughters would marry a man, then the possessions would again be removed from their father's line and be transferred to whoever they married. And so this was now the next problem. And so there is also a solution to this, and we will see why this is important. In Numbers 36, verse 2, because they were of these daughters were of the tribe of Manasseh, and the tribe wanted, of course, to keep the inheritance also in the tribe. And so they now see the danger coming, and they were thinking, yeah, if these young women are going to marry men of other tribes, we lose the inheritance. And so they go to Moses to bring this cause there. Verse 2. And they said, the Lord commanded my Lord to give the land for an inheritance by lot to the children of Israel. And my Lord was commanded by the Lord to give the inheritance of Zelophehad, our brother, unto his daughters. Yes. So these are men from the tribe of Manasseh, and they are talking about their brother, as they say. Yeah, this was Zelophehad who died, and his possession that was passed on to his daughters. They continue, and if they be married any of the sons of the other tribes of the children of Israel, then shall their inheritance be taken from the inheritance of our fathers, and shall be put to the inheritance of the tribe whereunto they are received. So shall it be taken from the lot of our inheritance. And when the jubilee of the children of Israel shall be, then shall their inheritance be put unto the inheritance of the tribe whereunto they are received. And so shall their inheritance be taken away from the inheritance of the tribe of our fathers. So they see here the danger that all this possession that these daughters receive, that will go to other tribes through marriage. And they also talk about the Jubilee, which you can read in Leviticus 25. Every 50th year, debts will be cancelled and settled and everything. Then this inheritance would permanently be part of this tribe unto whom they married. And so they wanted to prevent this, because then it would be unequally divided. So verse 5 then, Moses commanded the children of Israel according to the word of the Lord. So it's again, it's according to the word of the Lord, saying, the tribe of the sons of Joseph hath said well. This is the thing which the Lord doth command concerning the daughters of Zelophehad, saying, let them marry to whom they think best. Only to the family of the tribe of their father shall they marry. So shall not the inheritance of the children of Israel remove from tribe to tribe. In other words, they should marry to members of their own tribe, of the tribe of Manasseh, and that would keep the inheritance in that tribe. They were free to marry others, but the consequence would be the inheritance would go to that tribe to whom they would marry. So, to put it in other words, in order for the inheritance to remain with the daughter, she had to marry within her own tribe. That was the law, the rule. Now this applied the very same to Jesus. In order for Jesus to inherit kingship from Maria, she had first of all to have no brothers, because otherwise the brother would take the inheritance. She had to have no brothers. Secondly, she had to marry within her own tribe, and she had, of course, to be of the tribe of Judah herself, obviously. Otherwise, there was no inheritance of kingship to begin with. And so we have seen that she is a descendant of Nathan, David's son, and thus belonging to the tribe of Judah. Her husband, Joseph, was a descendant of Solomon, also belonging to the tribe of Judah. Heli, Mary's father, had no sons, and thus his inheritance would go to Mary, and from Mary to her son Jesus. So all legal obstacles were overcome through this, and you see, she had to be from the tribe of Judah, which she was. She had to have no brothers, which she didn't have, and she had to marry to someone of the tribe of Judah. That is why Joseph is of key importance. Without Joseph, it would not have worked. So he is very important. And the fact that when she was conceived by the Holy Spirit, we read this last Sunday, she was already espoused to Joseph. And by the time the child was born, they were married. So you see how God created a very difficult situation, but also the solution to it. And how almost impossible it would have been for anyone to fill in this place, to come out of this blood curse and still get this inheritance this way. This is almost impossible. So all the legal and lawful conditions were met in Joseph and Maria. And they are both of key importance. And that's why we have two genealogies, one in Matthew and one in Luke. And they are both very important. If Joseph would have been the biological father, Jesus could not have been the Messiah because of this blood curse. And so the prophecy would have ended there. It could not have been fulfilled. Without biological father, this means that Mary had to have a child without a man. It had to be a virgin birth. Otherwise, again, it would not have worked, because then the blood curse would count. So this explains why it had to be a virgin birth. And of course, God had already foretold that as well. In Isaiah, we can read it, chapter 7, verse 14, which shows again that this was not by chance. God had designed it this way. Isaiah 7, verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. So, this was written about 600 years before Christ. In that moment when you would read this, it doesn't make any sense. A virgin shall conceive a child. It cannot be. But now, of course, we know that it's so, and we believed it, but we maybe never understood correctly why. But it was part of God's plan to get around this blood curse that he put there himself, and to show that this was truly his son. As he told David, it will be my son, and I will be his father. And so it's not a human. He was human, but it's not the son of two human beings. We'll get to that, because there's also a biological aspect to it. In Matthew 1, verse 23, this is repeated. This verse actually quotes the verse from Isaiah that we just read. It says, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which, being interpreted, is God with us. Emmanuel, ends in L again, is God, means God with us. And indeed, as John chapter 1 declares, God became flesh and dwelt among us. It's truly God with us. And in Luke 1, we read from this last Sunday, verse 35, it speaks about the conception. How did she become pregnant? And the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. This is the fulfillment of the Davidic covenant, where God says, he will be my son. This is what it says here. Through the Holy Spirit, she became pregnant, and therefore he is the Son of God. So in Jesus, God became manifest in the flesh. Jesus was made of the same dust as we are made of, the same building blocks that we are being made of. So biologically, he was fully human. As soon as he was in the womb, after the conception through the Holy Spirit, which was supernatural, after that, everything was natural. His growth, the birth, his life and development, his death, everything was natural. Until his death. And then the resurrection, of course, is supernatural again. So it's the conception and the resurrection is supernatural, but everything in between, it's natural. He was human being just like you and me. And he was made the same way. And there could be another issue, because you could say this is impossible, because virgin birth, a child that grows without a father, is biologically, it doesn't go. And so there is another thing that that God provided. And that also proves that God had to be his father. So I want to also explain a little bit. So we have looked at legal and lawful matters. Now we look at biological matter. Every cell of our body contains what we now know as to be DNA. And this is the part of the building blocks that God has used throughout all of creation. Everything that lives contains has DNA. And our cells, human bodies, have 46 chromosomes. Yeah. So this is just 46 packages containing this DNA. And it's 22 from the mother, plus one, and it's 22 from the father, plus one. So it's all in all, 23 plus 23 is 46. And normally when the sperm and the egg come together, the DNA begins to mix. These 22 and these 22 begin to mix, so that the child has characteristics of the father and of the mother. And the thing is that this is from the mother. It's always 22, and the 23rd one, so these are called autosomes, and this is called the sex-determining chromosome. In the mother, it's always an X, always. This means if you would take if you would take two cells of the same female and in a laboratory bring them together to make a new fertilize the egg, so to speak, then the result would always be a girl. Why? Because you would have here another X. Two X's make up a girl, always. So a woman could technically reproduce without a man, and now we can do that in a laboratory. And some animals, by the way, they are able to do this, to reproduce by themselves. But in a human being, it will always result in a daughter, in a girl. And Jesus happened to be a boy. So we know that there was something else apart from what his mother had. In order for a boy to develop, you need not the X, but a Y chromosome. So the male normally provides either the 22 autosomes plus an X, or the 22 plus Y. XY will make up a boy, and XX will be a girl. And other combinations are anomalies. So Maria had received a Y chromosome through the Holy Spirit. Meaning, which can debate, but there is at least some reasonable evidence that Jesus indeed had 24 chromosomes, and not 46 like we do. And that is also, we know by now that this biologically, this is perfectly possible for a human being to have only 24 chromosomes, because these 22 contain everything that's necessary, which means all the human characteristics of Jesus came from his mother, Maria, which makes sense. But this Y chromosome that he received, this was from his father, given through the Holy Spirit, from God himself. That is why God declares he's my son. And that is why Jesus had to be a boy and could not be a woman. So biologically, it's possible, and it's only possible if it's the son. So it's, God has basically provided in everything. And of course, God knows this, because this is how he created everything. And he made our system work and grow. And actually, this specific thing about the DNA, we don't know it so long as human beings. It's about 100 years old, this knowledge that began to be knowledgeable that we have DNA and how all this works with chromosomes, etc. And it's only very recently that we fully understand that we can manipulate it, actually, which I think is not good, but anyway. But God has declared in the very beginning that this is what he would do. In Genesis 3:15, this is exactly what he says. And you might remember, I mentioned quite a few times, I think also earlier today, that when you read the word seed in the Bible, it speaks about the genes. So the seed of David means his genes, and thus his genealogy, his offspring. Now here in 3:15, it's after Adam and Eve have sinned, and God curses the serpent. What does he say? I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. And it, what is it? It is her seed, shall bruise thy serpent's head. And thou shalt bruise his, referring to the woman's seed, his heel. And this here, God says, I will bring forth someone from the woman's seed that will be the Messiah. And he will crush your head, he says to Satan. So it's from the woman's seed, not from the man's seed. And only the woman's seed, genes, only the genes from his mother. So it's there's more depth, but literally it is actually so. So it's beautiful to see how perfect everything is again. So if we put all of this together, or summarize it, we see Joseph was Jesus' earthly adopted father, his legal father. God is Jesus' heavenly father. Jesus was begotten of God, conceived by the Holy Spirit. And Mary was Jesus' human mother, a young virgin who gave birth to the Son of God. And as he said in her own words, she's just like all of us, she's servant of God. And Mary's bloodline was not under this curse of which Joseph's bloodline was. That's why Joseph could not be the biological father and Mary could. On top of that, Mary had no brothers, was of the tribe of Judah, and married to someone of the tribe of Judah, and therefore brought the inheritance down of the kingship down to her son Jesus. Whole package of legal, lawful, and biological conditions that were all met perfectly. And so this, all of this started with Jehoiachin, this wicked man in Babylon. And his name, his three names, they say God upholds, will uphold, did uphold. So God is, he was, and he will be. So if we look at the three names that we have gone through now, with only three names, although one has two meanings and the other has three different names. But it says, so it's from Amon to Jehoiachin. It means, truly, I am the master builder whom the Lord healed, whom the Lord raised up, whom the Lord upholds, will uphold, and did uphold. This is Jesus speaking. Yeah, of course. It's Jesus speaking, and he is identifying himself as co-creator. Next time we will continue the line of to Joseph, as it is recorded in Matthew. But I want to also give you the line from David to Mary, and the meaning of those names as they are in Luke. And we will not go over all of them, so I will just hand them out now to you. And then we'll see what those names mean. So if you just take one, if you want. So you see in this tree, the previous ones I gave before, but it's from David on. You see the two sons, Solomon and Nathan, one leading down, eventually the next sheet, next week or something, you will see this ends to, with Joseph, and the line of Nathan, which will end with Mary. So it splits off with David, and it comes together with Jesus. But the last part we will see next time, of course. This is from David until Babylon. But if we look at the full meaning of the names from David to Mary, we see also something beautiful. It renders as follows. My beloved one will bring a gift from Yahweh. Even the Comforter in abundance, whom God will raise like a dove. Clearly speaking here about the Holy Spirit that will come through Jesus. He increases and praises Yahweh. He hears and joins himself to his gifts. In him, Yahweh is exalted, provides help and salvation. He will arouse a beautiful victory over those that practice magic. He will be crowned as a king and a light of God. Then you have the Babylonian captivity. Afterwards it continues, but I will give you this next time. But I will read it to you now. Then it continues, I have prayed to God, and although begotten in Babylon, the place of wickedness, Yahweh has been gracious. And here you see the curse happened in Babylon. But because of that, something beautiful came, of course. He increases the one that praises him, and he hears and gives a gift that shines. My eyes are towards Yahweh. I repented, and his gift made me strong, and he increased me. The oppressed king, the gift from God, will become the groom and ascend. He is the child that was wished for. That is, the last sentence is Mary's name. He is the child that was wished for. So this is all the way from David to Mary. Sometimes there are situations that seem impossible to get out or to solve. Problems that are seemingly, they cannot be overcome. But that is when God can show his might and his strength. When we are at our end, and in our weakness, he can be strong. And it's very often so in Scripture. He shows this time and again. He brought the army of Gideon down to only 300 men. To fight an army of 137,000. Humanly spoken, impossible. But that is how God can show his power. So that is also a lesson for us in our lives. When we think there is no way out, that what is before us is impossible to overcome, that is where we have to lean on God and where he can work and show his power. And yeah, through all this we see, of course, that the Jesus is the true Messiah, and there is no one else who can fill in this place. It can only be God's Son. There is always people that think, well, I believe in God, but this Jesus, I don't know. Maybe he was just a prophet, and you hear all these things. But Scripture shows so clear, and again, this is all historical data. It's not made up. It's verifiable. Scripture shows very clear this could not be fulfilled in a man. God created conditions impossible for a man. Take, for example, the other prophecies. He was to be from Nazareth, but he was also to come from Bethlehem, and he had to come from Egypt. Only these three to be fulfilled in one man, very difficult. But God made it happen. And so there are many more of these things. Combine it with what we spoke about today, and you see that God made it very difficult on purpose to show that it was He who was at work, and it's only He who can do this.
And what He says, it's true. Amen.